right now we're on our data management panel discussion where we're looking at talking about data management, cloud, and data platforms. Well, it's not only important how you manage your data, but also how and where you store it. Cloud has been the forefront of this side in data storage, and now data platforms are increasingly becoming deployed in these platforms. We're looking at talking about focusing on critical use cases for your company's data, identifying owners and stakeholders for each data management function, identifying the right tools or platforms or technology solutions, enabling an agile real-time approach to integrating data with data virtualization. We're looking at talking about business opportunities and challenges that cloud and data platforms create, making use case driven, efficient and scalable data platforms with Kubernetes and Flyte. We're also looking at talking about the role of AI ML in modern data management. Who powers the AI ML and analytics strategy? Is the platforms, cloud vendors, or specific big data solution providers? Well, so many questions and much more. Let's get our panelists on your stage and screen. Well, ladies and gentlemen, first up, we've got Kaushik Gate, the SVP and Head Consumer Analytics and Data Sciences, HDFC Bank. Well, Kaushik is a research and analytics professional with nearly 20 years of experience in developing business cases, formulating relevant analytics solutions, and predictive modeling across the customer lifecycle. Thank you so much, Kaushik, for giving us your valuable time today.
Happy to be here.
Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, on the other side, we're going to be joined by Dr. Anish Agarwal, the Director, Data and Analytics, NatWest Group. Well, Dr. Anish is recognized as the top 100 influential leaders in the Asian analytics industry and top 40 under 40 data scientists in India. Dr. Anish is somebody who's a professional with over 19 years of experience in delivering value through innovative use of data across the spectrum of industry verticals. Thank you so much, Dr. Anish, for joining us and being a part of our show today.
Pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, on the other side, joining our eminent panelists is going to be first Dr. Sanjeev Chaubey, the EVP and Head Big Data and Advanced Analytics Vodafone, joining us. Well, Dr. Chaubey has over two decades of B2B and B2C experience in customer and marketing analytics, encompassing AI and data science-driven descriptive, predictive, and prescriptive actionable insights and association solutions as a horizontal. Thank you so much, Dr. Chaubey, for joining us today.
Thanks, Bhavana. It's a pleasure.
Pleasure to have you, sir. Well, we also have Rahul Varde, the VP and Head of Analytics and Insights, Jubilant Foodworks Limited. Rahul is passionate about embedding insight-driven decision-making across organizations and has extensively worked on building large-scale machine learning frameworks, optimization engines, business intelligence, and data platforms. Thank you so much. Rahul, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Bhavana. Happy to be here and looking forward to an engaging discussion with an expert panel.
Thank you. And thank you for complimenting on the background as well. Thank you, Rahul. Thank you, Kaushik. Well, ladies and gentlemen, also we've got Subramanian Srinivasan, the Vice President, Big Data and Analytics Tools Engineering, Deutsche Bank. Subbu is a global engineering lead for the data and analytics teams in Deutsche Bank, leading big data, business intelligence, as well as data science platforms. He's currently driving the migration of the above platforms from on-premise systems to Google Cloud. Well, let's just see if we can interact. Yes.
So thanks, Bhavana.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thanks. Nice to be here.
Pleasure. And ladies and gentlemen, for our moderator, we've got Amit Verma, Executive Director, DBS Bank. Well, over a career spanning 22 plus years, Amit has positively influenced the financial service industry as a technology pioneer, business leader, organization builder, innovator, and a digital transformation catalyst, leading technology functions across the US, Europe, and India. Thank you so much, Amit, for giving us your valuable time today.
Thank you, Bhavana. Pleasure to be here.
So ladies and gentlemen, with this, let me not hold you between the amazing panel discussion, which is coming up on the other side. Amit, I now leave the live reins to you to take it forward and curate this wonderful panel. Over to you.
Thank you. Thanks for that, Bhavana, right? And really esteemed and panelists, glad to be here along with yourselves on this forum. As all of us know, data is the golden asset of the modern IT era. It is at the center of any organization, and its functions at this point in time, right? And its role is getting more and more important as each day passes, right? Cloud technology, on the other hand, is a key enabler for efficiencies and also for data management, right? And it's the mix of two, getting that balance right, is certainly key to be driving the success of any data management approach and even cloud management for that perspective. So with that quick leader, right? Let me start off with a quick question, Sanjeev, maybe for yourself, right? So Sanjeev, as a data leader, and somebody who will be driving data management strategy for your firm currently and previously, what from your perspective would be the top three considerations of a modern data management strategy? And do you see any role that AI ML could play in the same? Sanjeev, please.
So Amit, thanks for putting that relevant question as to what will be the top three consideration. Rather, I would say not only top three consideration, there are multiple considerations that should be taken into account before we kickstart our data management strategy, right? So let me begin by saying that, yes, what are the use cases that you are trying to address? Or what is the kind of data sources that you have got in your kitty? Sure. And what is the kind of tech stack that you are going to follow, right? So be it an on-premise solution, so people are shifting to Hadoop data lake platforms, or they are shifting to cloud technologies, but certainly they are not sure what kind of security and privacy issues are involved, right? And what will be the benefits or maybe the problems that they may be facing. But typically, if you ask me, I would look at any data management strategy starting with my use cases which are having value, and which can deliver appropriate customer satisfaction, or maybe which can leverage customer satisfaction or customer experiences. Number two, which can leverage which can enhance the profitability for the organization overall. Right? These two being the pillars, the data management strategy should be built, how many data sources have to be integrated, what is, so it will certainly depend on the cost and value, right? What is the kind of cost an organization wants to involve, and what is the kind of value from that data platform that has to be, so be it Netezza, DB2, or those high cost costing parallel processing databases, right? Those massive databases are available in the market, Teradata or Exadata, they are available, but they're pretty costly, right? So whether we want to go for Hadoop, so certainly the cost and value factor comes into account. Now, talking about the other strategies, why AIML? AIML is important, why? Because any data today, we are getting different formats of data, structured, semi-structured or unstructured data. We are still exploring, struggling with social media data, right? And the vision data, the image data or visual intelligence or visual analytics is still something that is coming up, right? Look at the volume of data, and I'm coming from the telecom background, I'm just looking at 5G. So where on one side we were talking about 1 Gbps speed, today once maybe 5G and 5G is already applied, right? It's already a reality in some part of the world. Right. So 5G is having 20 Gbps data transfer speed, right? So look at the kind of data which is going to explode in our data lakes or cloud. Look at the volume of the data. And then this volume of data has to be converted to some kind of useful product, or some useful insights have to be generated out of it. And then that should be made usable for the organization, right? So if I'm talking about AIML models, so be it structured, be it speech analytics, speech to text, or making some kind of recommendations using some kind of images, videos, or some V2XX use cases that we want to launch, right? Real-time use cases. I think this is the problem, right? This is the problem that we'll be facing in future because of the upcoming explosion of the data that is planned, right? It is on the way. So this is my take on the data management strategy and the AIML challenge that we'll have because of this 5G challenge that we are going to, 5G IoT related data that is going to be pumped in to the system, right?
Sure.
So that's my take, Amit.
Thanks for that perspective, Sanjeev. Thank you. So just carrying on from the point that you've raised there, Sanjeev, right? If I may, for Kaushik. Kaushik, from your perspective, right? Again, in your role that you are playing as a leader on the data front, would you see any opportunities or challenges that you know you face from a data management perspective, especially with the cloud angle on it?
So, see, I'm a user of the data, right? My team will use that data to build predictive solutions and machine learning algorithms. From that perspective, just want to take you through the experience that we are having. Currently, we are going through a cloud implementation for the data science team. And the decision to go on cloud was taken after due deliberation and comparison between cloud and on-prem offerings. You would know that cloud is an OPEX model rather than a CAPEX model. So the implementation offers a lot more than just cost benefit, which was quite significant by itself. And for us, the cloud implementation also made sense for other benefits such as, you know, on-demand scale up and scale down, you know, spin up compute instances anytime. So that cuts down on hardware procurement cycle, which is maybe 6 to 8 weeks. Then there are faster computing speeds, which is quite critical for us, given the size of the data that we have runs in TBs. And today we are running on a monthly basis, but going to cloud enables us to run our processes on a weekly or a daily basis. The other benefit is the ease of implementation and integration with other cloud systems, because the surround system or the environment is also on cloud. So it makes sense for even the data science platform to be on cloud. The integration is easy. The data transfer is easy. And most of all, it future proofs our analytics ecosystem. So I see that going forward, whatever development has to happen, it will happen on cloud, and it makes sense to be on cloud. So those are some of the opportunities which cloud presents. And on the challenges side, first time it takes time to set up. So you should be clear about the security and the compliance considerations. You end up spending a lot of time in navigating those. The other part is the setting up process of a data transfer. On-premise, how is the data flowing into EDW, from EDW to your on-prem systems? So how will it flow into cloud? Is there an intermediate server? How will you handle PII data? So those considerations are there. They take some time in sorting out. And also you need to be aware of cost considerations while using cloud compute. You know, you may end up incurring cost even when you are not using. So, you know, on-premise, when you are using a desktop or a machine, even if you leave it on through the night, doesn't matter. But on cloud, it incurs cost if you're not using it. So those are some of the considerations that you need to be aware of. Yeah.
Sure. Thanks for that perspective, Pashya. That certainly helps. Maybe a quick question for Anish, right? So Anish, given that, you know, we are, and this is more the current flavor of the season in terms of where we find ourselves, right, with the pandemic being around. Anish, from your perspective, do you see the pandemic as an opportunity for us to move data onto the cloud? Is that something which is you know, happening? Because, you know, people are working remotely, you're not necessarily having your clients also at a point in time where they want to be traveling to your premises. So does the cloud, you know, offer you any benefits of from a data management perspective in this current scenario? Anish, your perspective on that, please.
So my answer would be a big yes, Amit. And while everyone hates COVID, I think there are a few blessings in disguise that we always experience, and this is one of them. Historically, and even, you know, a couple of years ago, we've been really trying to pitch the cloud solution heavily. And we always got a shot back because of pushback because of security issues around cloud availability, the level of service that a cloud service provider can provide. But today, if you look at cloud from an analytics standpoint, it is not just about hosting data somewhere in some ecosystem, but it is also about availability of certain as a service solution. So be it software as a service, AI as a service, analytics as a service. So today it's been, the analytical solutions are complemented with a bundled package, which actually works really, really well. That means my overall turnaround time, effort, and the cost to deploy a solution is significantly less. That's one. I don't really have to spend a scalable amount of time in upskilling my team members. That's second. And the third is the speed of execution is much better. And if I slice everything on top of it, everything is secure. I think there is always a, you know, a winning proposition. And that's what we've been doing today. If you look at several solutions, be it from a visualization standpoint, be it Power BI, Tableau, or even ThoughtSpot as an example, they are heavily focusing on a cloud-based solution as opposed to on-premise.
Sure.
And there is a reason to this, because there is a heavy cost involved if you deploy something on-premise. Access management is another side of the story. And a third is single sign-on as well. From an analytics standpoint, there are several solutions which are also upscaling. Snowflake, as an example, is doing a tremendous job from a cloud adoption standpoint. You simply integrate it with AWS, and there you go, you have a seamless solution. So in summary, yes, absolutely. And what there's one big change that this pandemic has driven is the speed to adapt. Normally, decisions which would have taken months and months to agree on and sign off, today we do not have that luxury to take those decisions in months. We have just few hours or even few days. So what that means is a more practical solution has to be implemented in a less amount of time with greater amount of efficacy. Back to you.
Yeah. No, I mean, I would totally agree with that, right, perspective there, Anish. Because even in our own case, right, we had a scenario where in a matter of 3 to 4 weeks, right, last year in March, we had to transition a lot of our infrastructure and access to it. And therefore, by that implication, access to the data as well, right, in a space of 2 to 3 weeks from being an on-prem scenario to being a remote virtual scenario, right? And I can totally agree with your perspective in relation to the efficacy, the urgency, the pace at which you need to move, right? So you're really spot on there in terms of that reference. A quick tangential question, if I may, right? For Subbu, if I may, Anish's case. So Subbu, from your perspective, right? Anish talked about the need to focus on security, right? So from a tools and technology perspective, from your experiences, Anish, what solutions, what offerings, what approaches have you taken to ensure security and data privacy in the cloud from a data perspective?
Okay. So let me first talk about the various tools and technologies that are coming up in the cloud, and I'll talk about security alongside that, right? So I manage a large set of servers on-prem. It's more than 2,000, and we tried our best to have a multi-tenant environment on-prem. But then the challenges of, on-demand scalability, they take over, and you start looking at the cloud. So while I answer this question, let me also talk about the different sets of tools and technologies that are coming up without really naming too many of them. I'll go more on the use case basis, right? So one is, when the word big data came into vogue, it was typically looked at as batch analytics, batch data. But over the years, there has been a gradual shift, and real-time streaming data also has to be analyzed. So that is something that we are seeing, and on-prem, we are not seeing both of them mix that well. But in the cloud, because of the nature of the cloud, wherein the tooling vendors are starting afresh, they are able to provide single point solutions that mix, that enable these things to mix better. The second is in terms of what exactly are the types of data. At a very broad level, it's just two types, operational data and analytical data. So operational is typically your transactional data and your data that is owned by business. And then you have pipelines that suck that data, they transform that data, and then it goes further analytical. So we've had challenges in ownership of that data. Because these tools were esoteric, it was away from business. But as we go on to the cloud with the required security controls in place, we are seeing that the analytical data is coming closer to business. And the other added advantage of the cloud is typically we have the same vendor. It might be the cloud provider providing tools for both transactional data as well as analytical. So there is better integration between these, right? You sure. You talked about security, right? So nowadays, regulations and whole fact that there are various laws that we need to abide by those. And one common denominator for that is desensitizing the data. So the challenges that we had on-prem was that we had to have separate tools for that to desensitize the data. But here, it is more out of the box. So desensitizing and using that data for analytics, using that, moving that data to UAT so that you can build your model development lifecycle on that is something we are seeing. The other thing that coming again on a security point of view is that we do this desensitization, but later we realize that the data has lost its statistical properties because say there are multiple fields and you want say the age, the beyond age demographics. So you mask both the date of birth and the other fields and your age goes away. So how do you desensitize the data while retailing the statistical characteristics? There are again tools that are coming, some by the tooling vendor and some by the cloud provider, more by the tooling vendor in the set because these are more esoteric ones. Sure. So those are some of the challenges and some of the opportunities that exist in the cloud. We have had to have very hard knitting on on-prem, which is avoided on the cloud by use of some of these tools.
Okay, great, great, great. So Subi, you did raise a very good perspective there, you know, in relation to the feasibility of managing real-time and batch data using a single point, right? Solution certainly is very, 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 very relevant there. Also, the fact that you talked about, you know, ensuring the that you are desensitizing the data, but at the same time, ensuring its consistency is maintained is very important as well. So you're spot on there as well. If I may just take a quick tangent in that case, Subu, right? And direct a question at Rahul. So Rahul, based on the point that Subu is raising here, right? If you look at, say, the different stakeholders, right? And all the different players who are there in the data management and cloud management space in this life cycle, what would you see their role, right? In relation to ensuring that the data sensitivity, the privacy, the quality is maintained? And what sort of ecosystems are you seeing developing there? Rahul, over to you, please.
Sure. Thanks, Amit. Very interesting question. I'll probably add a couple of points on the overall data strategy, and we'll come to the specific agenda. So I think already great thoughts by my co-panelists, really. But in the end, data strategy is nothing but the purpose why we have the data, and our clear roadmap on how we think will enable our organization to make decisions and drive business value. So it involves multiple entities to actually make this happen, right from how the data gets used to how it drives value to how it gets managed and processed. So if you think about some of the derailers for driving this value, one obviously is a big part of it essentially is where the organization is in their maturity for what data exists, where it exists, and more importantly, how the data can be used. So from one of the key stakeholders in the whole value chain is going to be the business, because that's where I think the whole the use case and actually happens. So for an organization which is in early stage of the data maturity, usually the data strategy should follow the business roadmap and they become the key stakeholder. For a case where organization is ahead in their maturity, the data should lead the business strategy, and that's how that should be positioned. Now, coming back to the points on the value of the data and the quality and all of that, I think one of the derailers essentially is concurrent multiple running initiatives to address a specific data need for different application. That becomes one of the hindrance as such. The tech debt can be a big part of it, really. So how do we bring all of these under one umbrella? So we have one specific guiding strategy on how are we going to be generating, storing, managing data, and enriching and making it available for all of the users. And each of the stage really of the data management, you'll have various different stakeholders playing a part, right from the process owners who run the process and who generate the data, making sure that overall strategy or business strategy is followed. For example, I'll give an example. I think a few years back, we were building personalized recommendations for sending personalized coupons. But I think the CRM system was only capable of generating only few types of coupon, really. So it's obviously a gap, really. So data is there, really, but not getting used. So how do we ensure that not just the data quality, but also the usage is taken care of? What process do we have to capture the data? So for example, COVID pose a challenge for us to say, how do we drive the compliance of people wearing the face mask? How do we drive the safety really? And that data, there's nothing to really, nothing available for us to really capture that. That's where a lot of these modern technology will come into play and use of image analytics to make sure that in our stores or wherever, you know, we're able to capture the data really. So I think, yeah, right from the process owners, it could be a business, it could be a data-led initiative to the end usage. I think various stakeholders are important to make sure that the data quality and the sanity essentially is maintained.
Okay, great. I think that's great perspective there, right, from your side, Rahul. And if I may just tie on to that, right, and Sanjeev, coming back to you, right. So Rahul raised a very good point in relation to ensuring that there is a consistent and coordinated approach to data management. So Sanjeev, from your perspective, is this something that you have tried to implement from your perspective? What kind of approach have you taken to ensure that you get the buy-in from various stakeholders, and also to ensure that there are not these divergent, right, streams which are taking the organization in divergent directions and therefore not really leading to success of the data strategy that you have? So Sanjeev, give us some perspective on that. That'd be great.
Yeah. So thanks, Amit, again for raising a pertinent question. Now, let me talk about while other panelists have already given the USPs for the usage of cloud, how and why we should be using it, right, for the value that a company gets while implementing cloud infrastructure, right? So in my opinion, I think the question that is pertinent is how do we kind of address the security, privacy, how do we try to understand? Because ultimately, we are going to depend on the third-party cloud environments, right? Be it AWS or GCP or Azure or Databricks. There are so many other small vendors which are also available in the market. But then we run the risk of handing over our data on these cloud platforms. And certainly, we provide access to third parties. If we are routing it through some consultancies, the third party consultancies have also got the rights on those tables and those objects, data objects, which can certainly be used in an appropriate way, right? But certainly we have NDAs and other things signed with these third party vendors. But then to securing data is certainly critical. How do we do that? Masking or encryption of certain columns or certain attributes, or which are more personal in nature, right? So if you are talking about the names or the mobile numbers or address or PIN codes or things like that. Now, what is happening, and I'll take another example also. Now, TRAI, that is Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, is coming up with another concept that can we use the data for betterment of the society? Right. So instead of data lying idle in data lakes and data oceans of telecom industry, can that data, transactional data, be used for betterment of the society? Right. Predicting if somebody will have COVID or not, these kind of scenarios currently. Right. So if data is available, non-personalized data, right, NPD data is available for startups to make certain kind of innovations on top of it, why not that particular practice? Sure. Start, right? So that is something that is coming up. So certainly this is my point of view when we come to and certainly there are ways to kind of ensure that your private information, the personal information, there are certain norms, be it GDPR or HIPAA, different regulations are applied for data privacy. We certainly try to follow the maximum part of those security compliances. So these are certain points that I wanted to bring to your notice.
Great. Thanks for that perspective there, certainly for sure, Sanjeev. I know we are just coming up to the time, so maybe I could quickly just take one quick round, right, of everybody. Let's start off with say Anish yourself, right? Anish, if you were to maybe, as a leader on the data side, at this point in time, just maybe in a couple of sentences, advise somebody on what they should be doing, what would those words be? So Anish, over to you. And let's go around the table, please.
I think first and foremost, what's really, really important is the clarity side of the story. And this applies largely to the talent. Today, when we are out in the industry trying to secure the talent to build on our future propositions, the biggest delta we see is lack of clarity in terms of understanding of what data science is. People have a misconception about data science is equal to machine learning, is equal to AI, is equal to analytics. And if you look at several job postings as well, you'll be surprised to see that the enterprises today are posting jobs where someone needs 15 years of experience in machine learning. Well, that's impractical. That's not possible. So one, we really have to be pragmatic when it comes to building the talent and attracting the talent. And the second and foremost is have a clear strategy, which is not just about deploying AI-driven or analytical solutions, but it is also about the ethics and privacy as well. Enterprises today are setting up dedicated functions which look at data privacy and ethics, and I think that has to continue for a long time from now.
Great. Thanks for that perspective, Manish. You know, really, really wise words, I have to say. Thanks. Thank you. With that, maybe Kaushik, we could just request you for your gems as well of wisdom for us as a group.
So, you know, see, I come from a data science background, and from that perspective, somebody out there is evaluating whether to go on cloud or not, I would say it's definitely worth a try. You know, beyond the concrete benefits that you get, I believe it future-proofs your investment. And for us, the outlook is very positive. We are quite excited about the possibilities it has opened up. And the three things that I'm looking at is, you know, secure, easy, and timely access. So which is what you should look for in a cloud solution. Yeah, that's it.
Great. Thanks for that as well, Kaushik, from your perspective. Maybe over to you, Subbu, from your perspective. If you just summarize some gems for us as well. Over to you, Subbu.
Yeah, sure. I'll talk more about people or organizations wanting to get onto the cloud journey, both data as well as non-data related firms. So this is a good opportunity. Cloud is a good opportunity to bury your past mistakes, press the reset button, start afresh, learn from your mistakes. So maybe you can start slow, iterate your way through the journey, get some best practices in infrastructure as code, machine learning ops, because my ML, to be honest, has been more of a wild, wild west. You know, it's been okay. Let's see how it comes about. How can we have zero touch systems? How can we have some model development lifecycle? So start slow and gradually iterate through, get your learnings out, and then progress further. That's my few words.
Thanks for that, Subbu. Thank you. Rahul, over to you, please.
Thanks, Amit. First of all, thanks to all the co-panelists. Very engaging discussion, really. Two thoughts I'll say. One for the organizations. So data as a strategic pillar is no more a question. Is it or not? It definitely is. I keep saying all the time that the easiest of the whole of the data analytics dream is data analytics. Everything else around that, the change management, the prioritization, and keeping that focus is what differentiates the success, really. So that's my message to organization. And I think for people, I'm passionate about creating a commercially savvy data scientist as a community, really. And I think that's what my message would be, that don't lose the purpose of why. Very exciting to see. I've done three more models, really, versus going back to saying, why am I seeing this difference, really? I'm going back to the data science. There's a data in it for a reason, really. So that's my message to community as a way.
Thanks for that, Raul. Thanks for that perspective. And finally, Sanjeev, if we could get your views as well. Thank you.
Yeah, I think, Amit, it's really important to understand how we are going to use our data, right, in the given context. And cloud is something that is in the process. We have been able to kind of start at Vodafone Idea Limited, right? And I think it is important to put them on, because see, the data is also going to increase. And on the other side, even the machine learning algorithms are getting more complex in terms of having some more deep learning algorithms or algorithms which are related to computer vision. Or if you are talking about CNNs or RNNs, they are getting complicated, right? So on one side, we have increasing problem of data. The other side, we have increasing complexity of machine learning, deep learning algorithms. Now, the machine has to crunch that large volume of data along with this deep learning complexity that the computation requires. Now, somewhere cloud is trying to address that if we are talking about using GPUs and other high processing processors, right? In terms of RAM or processors, But certainly I see the challenges growing even bigger, because then social media data, the image data, the video data, video feeds. So especially the colorization part of it, if the video is somebody wants to listen to a movie in his own language, real time, that real time processing can be done, right? Using 5G connectivity, because the latency is very low. So that's my take, Amit, I think. Sure.
Great. Thanks for that perspective, there, Sanjeev. So you know, thank you all for your wise words of wisdom. If I was to summarize that, right, to anybody listening to us, the way I would put it is, yes, when you're starting on your data management and your cloud management journey, as Sanjeev put it, always put your business need and the requirements and use cases at the forefront, because that is what will ensure that what you get at the end of the cycle is worth your time and value, right? Because if you don't have your requirements and business needs solicitation and clarity, that is not going to help you out there. So certainly go for that. Once you have done that, then do ensure that you get a consistent data management and cloud management approach put in right throughout, right? Whether it is looking at your people approach, whether it's looking at your products, you know, the tools, technologies, the security, data privacy, are you looking at it? So certainly make sure that it is consolidated also across the organization to ensure that it doesn't lead to divergent data approaches across your organization, because that is going to be a recipe for disaster when you try bringing everything together, right? So certainly look at ensuring consistency across the board. As Subbu rightly pointed out, right, there are various ways to go about it. You can, you know, the good way would be to start slow, you know, take measured risks, evaluate, you know, what are the outcomes based on your initial, you know, iteration, and then iterate through the process, right? To start slow, but in a measured way, and make sure that you're doing it in an iterative manner. As Kaushik rightly pointed out, right, if there's any time to go onto the cloud and data journey, this is it, right? Take that leap of faith, but as Rahul again put it in the end, make sure that you get the balance correct, right? And as I said earlier, the balance between your business needs, your tools, the techniques that you apply, the people side of it, because they are the ones who are going to make it real, right? Also, the change management element of any data management approach, right, and cloud management migration or transition is very key, because unless you are looking after the change management part of it, it's going to be not really successful. So all in all, guys, cloud and data management are really very fast evolving, and there's great and plenty of opportunity for us to from a business perspective, from a revenues growth perspective, from an efficiency perspective, to gain if we make the right moves. And some of the things that we talked about here hopefully will help you in that journey, or at least spark your interest there. With those thoughts, I will say sign off, and thank you all for listening to us. Have a great rest of the day, all of you. Bhavna, over to you, and thank you all the panelists as well.
Thank you.
Time everyone,
on the time. So thank you once again for joining us and being with us on the show. Thank you once again, and wonderful moderation yet again, Amit. Thank you to all our eminent panelists. Mm-hmm. What a great panel this was. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Bhavna.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks, Bhavna. Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.